Welcome to Newsclick. We have with us Comrade Krishna Prasad, Finance Secretary of the All India Kisan Sabha. He is going to talk to us about the agrarian crisis facing the country currently in the context of Narendra Modi inviting cooperative farming into the country recently in the World Food India Conference held in Delhi. Welcome to Newsclick, Comrade. Comrade, if you see that in India there are farmers are in a crisis and there are also protests that are happening in the context of, on a large scale, you see demonetization has affected them, there is input costs that have risen, and there are suicides that have been increasing. What do you think is the crisis affecting our country?
Actually, Narendra Modi is not requesting cooperative farming.
Yeah.
It is the corporates.
Yes.
Actually, it is contract farming. So it is a policy announcement by the Sandia government in the last budget, 2017-18. Mm. They said a model contract farm law will be introduced in all states.
Yeah.
And the first budget of this government in 2015-16, they announced 100% foreign direct investment in agriculture and retail.
Right.
And they are now concentrating on food processing.
Okay.
So what they are thinking is that on food processing, they would be able to bring a large change, a sea change, by the intervention of the foreign direct investment and the contract farming with the peasantry, which is untrue. Never in India or wherever in the world you can see this contract farm is going to help the petty producer.
See, comrade, in India around 85 to 87% of the farmers are marginal or small. So that means, because contract farming also, the capitalists would need large land holdings, and if this model has to become a viability, that means all these farmers have to be have to leave agriculture, is it not?
No, actually what is happening today is every day 2085 farmers are quitting agriculture, because agriculture has become economically unviable under the capitalist, especially under the neoliberal regime. And you see, in 1991, the percentage of the landless was 24%. Now it has gone up to 44%. So almost it is doubled within two decades of the neoliberal policies implementation. And another aspect is the pauperization. So large-scale pauperization, indebtedness, the suicide, and the migration from rural to urban. And one thing which we can notice now is that earlier the demand for higher price, 50% above remunerative price, 50% above cost of production, which was a recommendation of MS Swaminathan Commission. So this was made or demanded by sections from certain regions. Now, across the country, across the region, across the crop, from everywhere, it has become a unanimous demand, and also freedom from indebtedness.
Right.
So these two demands are coming up from everywhere, whether it is from Chhattisgarh, Maharashtra, Rajasthan, Kerala, Tamil Nadu, or Bengal and Assam. Why it is happening so? Because of the intensification of capitalist exploitation. Capitalism is advancing towards agriculture, and agriculture is used due to this exploitation and the growing expenditure for cost of cultivation and also cost of life.
Right.
The root cause of it is the lack of land reform. So now also we can see around 5% of the landholders of the upper size, they are holding 58% of the cultivatable land. So this inequality that is growing. In such a situation, the petty producers are unable to sustain in agriculture, and they are become more and more proletariats or workers. They are losing cattle, they are losing land, they are losing everything, and they are forced to migrate as a migrant worker. The proletarianization of the peasantry. This is what the in Communist Manifesto, Marx and Engels very clearly was indicating under the capitalism what is going to happen. And Lenin has very correctly stated this, that petty production cannot sustain under capitalism, and they will lose everything. So this is the stage today all over the country, and this shows the entire economy needs a system change. Without a systemic change, you cannot move. So this change is needed not only by the farmer or the peasant, but also by the capitalist class. That way they are trying to bring a new system of a contract farming and 100% FDI, and they feel it will be a solution for the problem, but unfortunately it cannot be and it will not be. Narendra Modi and his team who are leading the government is totally on a wrong path.
So what do you think could be an alternative for so that this section of farmers, for them farming can be a viable option?
You see, the studies world over shows what is the crisis in agriculture today. You can consider that now in under capitalism, a modern industrial society is emerging, and agro processing industries are an important role to play in that. And through the agro processing and marketing, only the agriculture can be modernized. And in such a situation, what is happening today in India is the Indian capitalism is failing in undertaking this responsibility. They are more and more in lucrative areas of real estate, hotel business, tourism. So they are not entering into the agriculture at all. What they feel is that let the foreign capital come into it with 100% FDI. This is what they are saying. But on the other hand, the studies all over the world shows out of the total value of the consumer products made out of the raw agricultural producers, only 10% of that value goes to the primary producer. That means the farmer and also agriculture worker. So where does this 90% of the remaining surplus goes? That goes to the industrial processor, that goes to the marketeer, the middlemen, the transporters, and also the advertisers, media. So all these are sharing this amount. This is what is happening. Why it is so? Because the monopoly capital is having a domination over the agro processing industry and also market. So without entering into this area, this field, the farmers cannot twist the relationship in production in favor of the farmer. So this is a challenge in front of the farmer today, and we should address that. And that is possible not through the contract farming, but only through a cooperative farming.
So is there an example that you can give so that the viewers and through them everybody is educated? For example, some small example can you cite of cooperative farming which actually helped the farmers, which you are aware of?
Let us take a new example which we are now doing in Kerala. For example, on 29th of this month, last month, October 29th, the finance minister of Kerala, Dr. Thomas Isaac, has come to Wayanad. So he initiated a project. That project is the industrial poultry farm inauguration of the project by Brahmagiri Development Society, which is a cooperative. Two young women agriculturists, cultivators, named Gina and Ginny, they initiated that first project. The 2,000 chicks, day old chick, has been given to them, and they paid the money also, and they are purchasing feed also from the Brahmagiri. So Brahmagiri is the cooperative which is extending help to facilitate the input supply at a fixed rate. Now after 35 days they are taking that back with 11 rupees per kilo as an income to the farmer. Out of 2000 birds, they may be able to have an income of around 30,000 rupees per month. If it is in the contract farming under the corporate companies, it can be below 15,000 only. So they can double it. And now the Kerala government want to promote it. So the minister announced there for each and every bird, they will give 5 rupees for subsidy. Brahmagiri is a cooperative which has a policy of not profiteering out of this expenditure, out of this business. They are only facilitating. So what is the surplus created? They will share with the farmer. That way they are able to give 11 rupees instead of 5 rupees or 6 rupees. So this can be a model. Now around 150 farmers have joined the federation. It's a poultry farmers federation. So this sort of federations or crop-wise mobilizations, these are the key in giving the petty producer a strength to checkmate the corporate exploitation in the market and develop a cooperative alternative.
But then if you want to extend it to a larger scale, the MNCs have the power and the money to advertise and take their market, their produce to different markets. So is that also viable in a cooperative model?
It depends. Okay. For example, in Kerala, you can see around 90% of the people consume meat. And Kerala is having a very high income level, life standard. So that market is there with you. You need not to explore any market outside of Kerala as far as meat is concerned. Second thing is that the Kerala, the problem is of production. So petty producers are under economic unviability because of this exploitation. So the production is not coming up. So if you can develop it, then the market is assured. Then the question of the money, you are saying the money is with the corporates. No, money is with the people. If the people are not purchasing, if their purchasing capacity is not there, then the corporate products also will be under slowdown. The concept needs to be understood by the majority of the working class and the farming class, and they should advance to have a change in the system.
So in that context, we're talking about the workers and pauperization of the farmers. And if you see now in 2011 census, about 144.3 million agriculture laborers were there in 2011. That's a huge population. So what do you think should be the policies, even in a cooperative model, to also help the workers who are engaged in agriculture?
You see, India is a largely an agrarian country, agrarian economy. And the agriculture has become unviable and the farmers are forced to become a worker. And in such a situation, the worker and the peasant alliance, the farmer-worker alliance, that is very important. You see, there is always a contradiction between the farmer, especially the rich farmer and the agriculture worker. Because the rich farmer want to reduce the worker's wage. And the worker always want to have a enhanced wage. So this is the contradiction between them. But as far as the petty producers are concerned, the middle class of farmers or the poor farmers are concerned, they are agriculture worker also. So if they are coming together and they are exploring the possibility of cooperative farming and establish their own market and industry, for example, that what is the resolution of agrarian question in India. That is the base of the democratic revolution in India. As far as the communist parties are concerned, the left political movements are concerned, their major area of aim of political intervention is to bring an agrarian revolution. So agrarian revolution is the axis of the democratic revolution. So without having an alternative to agrarian revolution, you cannot advance your political movement also. In the existing situation, Narendra Modi also has come to power with a left-leaning slogans. For example, he only have given in 300 plus public rallies the slogan that if BJP is voted to power, then they will give 50% above cost of production as remunerative price to each crop. So this is what the left movement is demanding. This is what Kisan Sabha was demanding. Then Modi has promised it. But in the last 3.5 years rule, he never fulfilled that. The same, he said the freedom from indebtedness to all the farmers. Because under neoliberalism, under the Congress rule, under the Congress economic policy, the farmers are the most exploited. They are under indebtedness. And the Modi has put a left slogan of freedom from indebtedness. But under 3.5 years rule, his finance minister says even a single penny will not be given to pay for a debt relief, a loan waiver scheme. So this is the double speaking of the BJP, and those farmers who have voted BJP to the power, now they are being fired at and they have been killed by the police of under the BJP state governments. For example, Mansoor, the BJP government did not had any consciousness problem in firing on the innocent farmers who have voted them to the power. And this demonetization and also now the GST, this is affecting badly the farmer. So under such a situation, the farming class is forced to come against the government policies. That is what we are seeing in Maharashtra, continuous struggle. And in 13-14 days struggle in Rajasthan, which have been forced the government to succumb to the pressure of the farming community and announce some land waiver. So this is happening in Chhattisgarh today, happening in Madhya Pradesh today. So this all BJP ruled state. And in Maharashtra, where BJP is under rule, they are unable to contain the suicides, rates of suicide of the farmers. Right. 42% hike is there under the BJP government regarding the peasant suicides. So all this shows that farmer community, the peasantry is ready for any sort of fight today. So what it shows that all sections of the farmers, whether they are under Congress, whether BJP or whether left oriented, they are now ready to fight these economic policies. Here a question is there, whether the Congress is willing to change the economic policy. Because this economic policy which BJP government is implementing, this is what owned by the Congress also. And even today Congress is not ready to change it. And on 20th of November, the farmers also are coming in big number in Parliament Street to fight. So the worker and peasant, the alliance and the struggle, this is the only hope today that can force the BJP and the Congress to change their economic policy and force the RSS and BJP to withdraw and come to the national mainstream by upholding the democratic tradition and also secular tradition.
Thank you, sir. Comrade Krishna Prasad says that cooperative farming is the antidote to the farmers facing the crisis presently. The alternative is in the farmers coming together, forming cooperatives and giving a tough fight. Thank you for watching Newsclick.